Again, my name is Bill Fiala. I don't know exactly how I got the honor of being your moderator today, but I am honored. I am sure, like many of you, there are very few degrees of separation between yourself and somebody who's experiencing or has a disability. My brother-in-law, Mark, was a victim of a drowning accident at age 2 and has lived now to past age 30, but with severe physical and intellectual disabilities. I also have an autistic aunt on my dad's side of the family, my Aunt Mary. So been touched in my life. And my mom is a retired teacher of special education. So for 33 years, I got to hang around where she taught and be exposed to all kinds of different people, which was a wonderful growth experience for me. I'm going to let my panel introduce themselves, so we'll pass the mic as we go along. I've promised as your moderator that I will not ask any questions about spray tans or email servers or bankruptcies or anything like that. Just know that this is going to be a friendly conversation. I'm not looking to get ratings. But maybe if you just introduce yourself, tell us just a little bit about yourselves, and then we'll move forward with the conversation. So Kimberly, would you go first?
Sure. My name is Kimberly Wiedefeld, and I am an APU alum from my undergrad. And I also am an employee here. I work in the Office of Undergraduate Admissions. I'm also a wife and a sister and a friend and a mother to 2 kids. And my connection with disability, while my whole life it has been around me and I have not been observant or I would say interacted in the way that I now wish I would have, is as a mother. So I have one of my 2 kids, Kate is 3, and she has Down syndrome, and I have been, it's opened my eyes to a place that I had no idea that I wasn't living. So that's me.
Welcome to our place. My name is Mary Mercurio, and I am also an APU alum. Just graduated in May from the School of Music. Woohoo! I am also the tutoring coordinator for the Learning Enrichment Center. I am the parent of 3 wonderful children, 2 of whom have disabilities. My youngest, Tony, is 19, and he has autism. And then my middle child, Cecilia, is 21. She has something called PKU, long story short, she can't digest anything with protein in it. But she is doing amazingly well. I could go on for days about my kids. I won't do that, I promise. I also served as the president of a nonprofit organization that worked on advocacy for children with genetic diseases for about 10 years.
Hi, my name is Travis Davis. I'm an alum of 2011. Yes. Yeah. So it's so great to be back here this week. I'm from Albuquerque, New Mexico, and I'm currently pursuing my master's in adapted physical education. I work for a hospital foundation back in Albuquerque that helps kids and families who have physical disabilities. I coach a junior wheelchair basketball team, and I'm their assistant camp director for their adaptive summer camp. And so it's just a pleasure to be here and talk about my experiences having cerebral palsy. And so I hope it's insightful for you all.
My name is Susanna Holden. I received my doctorate in 2013 from the University of Laverne. I've been on staff at the University Counseling Center here for about a year now. Woohoo! And I was born with muscular dystrophy, and my younger sister also has hearing loss, and I previously worked at Costa Colina, so I have various experiences with my own personal disability and supporting others with disabilities.
Good afternoon, my name is Aaron Hinojosa. I'm also an alum of 1992, when this used to be a bookstore here, so that's how I can gauge my time here. I'm currently the acting executive director in the Student Center for Reconciliation and Diversity, and have been doing that for the past 5 years working there. When they asked for experts on a panel, I realized the expert that I am is in my daughter, Sarah, who's actually here, our 26-year-old daughter, Sarah, who has Down syndrome, and is very much a part of the perspective changing as a parent on what life looks like, not only from being a parent, but how do I view the world in the sense of ability, and working, not working from a deficit model, but working from the ability of each individual, and seeing how that plays into the larger mosaic here on campus as well as the university. Some of the other work that my wife and I do as advocates, as parents, with families that also have children with disabilities. We've done work there. My wife, I'm mentioning my wife because my wife is here, Olivia Hinojosa, who has also helped start a nonprofit in Pasadena called Club 21, which works specifically with children and with Down syndrome. It's a learning and reading resource center. So there's other things that I'm a part of, looking at higher education and that model for people with disabilities and intellectual disabilities specifically.
My name is Mario Ferrante, and I'm not from APU per se, but my wife has been here about 15 years, Susan, and my daughter's a 2008 graduate from APU, and I was born normal, and then I had polio at about 8 months old, and so I've been in a wheelchair pretty much my entire life. I've always had a parallel path in music and business. I have master's degrees in both subjects, and often toggle back and forth between the arts, music, as well as business. I worked for the Boeing Company for 20 years as a director of treasury operations in their home office in Seattle. And most recently, in the last 10 to 15 years, been really focusing on the arts. Our family owns a private music lesson academy in Monrovia with 700 students. And so Summer and I manage that. And recently, in the last 3 years, came up with Crushed Impressionism. And that's the art display that's in Marshburn Library right now, and we'll be there a couple more weeks.
Well, thank you all for being here. We so appreciate you. Now, I had the opportunity to spend about an hour this week with many of our panelists, and we had just a fantastic conversation. I said, if you do that, it's gonna be great. So I certainly have questions that I can ask, but I don't want to monopolize the conversation. So you may notice there's a little sheet of paper on your table that has a phone number where you can text in questions. I'll be watching those come across my iPad here, and I'll try to intersperse those if you want to ask questions as we're going along. At the end, I'll also spend some time for question and answer. So if you want to do it the traditional way, we'll do raise your hands and pass the mics and that kind of thing. But if you want me to see if I can mix it in as we're going along, maybe it's not a question you want to ask out loud, you can certainly text that in to me, okay? So, Aaron, you hit on something just a minute ago that I think is really important to begin with, and that's the idea of language. So we talked a little bit this week about the importance of language, and what do these terms mean, and what do they mean to us when we talk about disability? So I'm wondering if we could start there. Just give me a little sense, or give us a little sense of languaging, and the need to be sensitive to that, and the words that we use, how we choose those. So maybe just start there.
I think the position I have as a parent, I'll preface this. I had a great conversation this week with Travis, and Travis also kind of helped me see being a person without a disability. It's my perspective on how I'm looking into the life with someone with a disability. And so when I look at what language looks like, or first person language, is that you're not identifying someone by their disability, but you're identifying them as how they've been made in God's image. So as a woman, a man, as a teacher, as a student, and so on. And those are the most important parts that I see as at least as a parent, as well as how someone identifies my daughter that happens to have a disability. You know, they see her as a sister, they see her as a choir member, they see her as someone who's employed or has been employed, a volunteer. So I think for all of us, when we think of how we are identified and how we want to be noticed, I don't think something that someone or the world sees as a deficit is what we want to be labeled as first. And so even in the work that we do in our office, we talk about how does someone see us. So I think language is very important, knowing how to address someone. But But being then as a person without a disability, my privilege in that is that I can only see into it from that angle. So love to hear from those that that sit here that represent the with a disability.
For me, I think it's a matter of personal preference, and it takes really getting to know that person with a disability and finding out what they want to be identified as. Like I said earlier, my sister has a hearing loss, and it was acquired when she was 15 years old. And as she accepted her disability, she did a lot of research on, you know, what people in that community prefer to identify as. Some people find it offensive to say they have a hearing problem or a hearing impairment. However, she chooses to use that as opposed to saying deaf. And so I use that language and terminology with her when talking about her hearing loss. And so I think it really just takes understanding and knowing what that person wants to be identified as. I think of it similar to ethnic identity. Some people like to be referred to as Black, some African American, and it's all about how they see themselves and which label they want to be identified with.
I used to have a deal with some of my employees in Seattle, and that was if I was late to a restaurant and they told the hostess that they were waiting for the guy in the wheelchair, they had to buy lunch. And so I always asked the hostess if I was late, how did you know it was me? Oh, they said it was the guy in the wheelchair. I said, okay, good, thank you. Made my day. But after a while, they started trying to come up with some other attributes. And that was kind of equally funny because the hostess would say, okay, I mean, I understand why they said that, but there's something more obvious, you know. Well, okay, but that's not so cool. So let's not refer to them by that label. And I remember another time I was with my family. My kids were small, and a particular airline announced right there at the gate, well, all you wheelchairs come over here and board early. And it was like, my son looked at me as if to say, okay, you're not going to let that pass, are you? So I went over to the gate and I said, you know, we are not wheelchairs. You know, we are people who happen to use wheelchairs. Oh, whatever, just get on the plane. So that was fine. I got 4 free tickets to Hawaii out of that deal. So at the end of the day, I figure they can call me whatever they want if they're going to give me that.
Well, I don't know if I have anything to top that. That... I do agree with Dr. Holden about personal preference, and I haven't been in many situations where someone would refer to me as my disability first, but I guess I've just been so used to being who I am that even if somebody were to say something like that to me, I would figure out a way to approach the situation in a way that, I don't know, it can just provide them with the knowledge that I think they're lacking. And I think a lot of times it is sort of the lack of knowledge that the general, you know, public doesn't have in terms of knowing how to interact and what not to say and how to say the correct terminology when it comes to individuals with disabilities. And so I just think it's all about educating people as much as possible.
That taps into one of the questions that one of our audience members has already, so we'll go with that, and that is, how should I act around or what should I say to someone with a disability? Is it okay to say things not the right way? How do I figure out what's a good question to ask?
Was that to me?
To any of the people.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh.
Right.
Oh. I don't know if there's, you know, that's an interesting question. And I think it's tough because there's no sort of rule book, right, to that you go by when you're, you know, interacting with someone with a disability. And so a lot of the times there's this the insecurity that's created with the other person who doesn't have a disability that may just be curious and will be afraid to say the wrong thing and will not say anything at all. And so I would just encourage any of you to just whatever you do, just know that it's coming from a genuine place. And if you're genuine about it and you just want to learn and ask questions, then, you know, that's all that really matters. And, you know, you can't control what the other person, like the other person's going to do after you ask that question. You just have to approach it in a way that is not going to, hopefully, you know, get them angry.
I think a lot of times in not saying anything because you're worried about coming off as insensitive or worried you might say the wrong thing, I think that too sends a message. In not saying something, it can be interpreted that my disability makes you uncomfortable or you perceive it as something wrong. So personally, I would rather someone ask questions with the understanding that you won't always get it right. You may say the wrong thing, but if there is that relationship, it's okay. And hopefully you guys can talk it out and you know, you can learn from it. It can be a learning experience, even in saying the wrong thing. But I wouldn't allow that fear of saying the wrong thing to keep you from being curious about the other person.
I would agree totally with Dr. Holden and Travis. The important thing is that the questions are being asked, that there is enough interest in proper etiquette or unoffensive language to ask. I think it's great. And I agree, there's nothing really offensive coming from a pure inquiry or a pure heart. It's great, just answer the question, and avoidance is probably worse than everything else. And that's usually, for me, the leading approach is, well, I'll let them do their thing and I'll continue doing mine. Because there is no reason we have to mingle, and no reason I really have to understand. And so anytime somebody's asking a question, it's wonderful. I had somebody ask me just this week, a coworker who said, can you feel in your legs? And it's a little startling when you first get a question like that in the middle of, hey, by the way, make sure you know, but I realized the person was genuinely curious, and they had just bumped me and kind of, you know, poked me accidentally, so they were just wondering if they hurt me. I said, yes, that I actually felt that. That was, you know. But something as simple as that, people wonder, and it's okay. Now, and I got to explain when people in wheelchairs can feel, when they can't, what injuries result in what, or diseases result in what, and I think it was very educational. And I'm sure the other panel members use the opportunity to educate as well.
I'd like to add something else to that, if possible. You know, sometimes when I am using my wheelchair, I will, you know, purposely do something to, you know, invite conversation for that person. So I'm constantly doing wheelies in my chair. 9 times out of 10, it's just out of habit, and it's not a conscious thing. But I was having a conversation with a student right before this in the coffee shop, and I was I was just doing a wheelie, and one of the cornerstone, the coffee house workers, you know, was like, wow, that was really impressive. And I get that a lot. And I think that if I can maybe help do my part to ease that sort of insecurity and break down that barrier, then, you know, we can have a, you know, conversation. And so then, you know, she started asking me questions, and it was all because I, you know, purposely was just, you know, doing a, you know, wheelie. And I knew that it would evoke some sort of emotion with her, and I could tell that she didn't feel afraid to ask me a question.
I wanted to add that because I've had my disability for so much of my life, I have a different level of comfort when it comes to sharing my story. And it wasn't until I was working at Casa Colina that I realized other people aren't as open about their disability, being asked why they were in a wheelchair or why they were wearing a helmet, if they had a traumatic brain injury. It was actually very triggering for them. And so then I began to assess, like, every time I go out practically, I'm asked, like, oh, why are you in a wheelchair? What happened to you? And so I'm used to being asked and very openly share my story with people when they want to know. So when I recognize that other people are not as open about it, it really made me kind of battle with my transparency and the fact that I'm so willing to answer a person who's behind me in line at the store. How is that impacting someone else with a disability who may not be as open and willing to address some of those questions? And so knowing that everyone is different, they're at different stages of their disability and acceptance with that. And if they're not ready or able to talk about it when you try to approach that dialogue with them, it's okay. But it's much preferred for me that you ask as opposed to not asking or avoiding the elephant in the room, because we're well aware that you're curious of it, and to not address it, like I said earlier, just sends a negative message.
Can I wanna say, so as a person who does not have a disability, but has a daughter with a disability, only 3 years old, so new, I would say, rather young on this part of my journey, I found myself, when I had Kate, wondering if I was gonna say the right thing, if I was gonna use the right language, afraid. I was narrating our journey when she was in the hospital for the first 6 weeks, and then really the first year of her life, kind of in a blog type manner, but I was worried I was gonna say the wrong thing. But more important to me than saying the wrong thing was telling our story and opening up an opportunity for others to feel like they could safely interact. But what I found helpful too is I would ask people. I mean, Aaron spent hours with my husband and I and other friends of ours, the Zavalas, to say, can I ask this? Is this okay to say? How do I say this? And what I have found in my relationships with my family, with my friends, and with strangers is it really is, for us, it's been so much about the attitude and the approach of, I want to understand this and know more. Can you help me understand this and know more? And did I say that right? Or can you help me understand why when I said it like that, that came across as hurtful or offensive? I don't understand this person first language. What does that mean? You know, and that attitude, as opposed to, I have had other people say to me, I just think you guys are just so sensitive about things. So I think that the interaction is so much about the attitude and the desire to learn and understand. And I think that that's across the board, right? That's not just with disability, but that's with all of our differences. So when you approach it with a, I don't want to get this wrong, but I want to have relationship with you, and I'm willing to risk that I might get it wrong, and I'm willing to say, can you help me get it right? That is so much more important to me than that you get it right. Does that make sense?
You're hitting on a couple of the topics that have come through. One being around, do you ever get tired of being the educator? I think there's some that are concerned that, you know, you're always put in this position. Is that tiresome for you? And then also, what kinds of interactions are most discouraging You've been talking about some very encouraging, positive things, but what gets you discouraged in this dialogue? So that was really two questions. You're welcome to answer either.
Well, bias in any form is discouraging. And this just happens to be one demographic of bias in terms of someone in a wheelchair. There, of course, is racial and gender and other very important issues. I don't know. It makes me more mad than discouraged, I guess. Mainly because I really feel adults should know better. And how did they slip through the education on this subject, you know? When did that happen? And, you know, so for me, it's, you know, like Dr. Holden, you know, I've had this so long, you know, so many years. I'm so past educating people on it. I mean, there's thousands and thousands I've educated, and every day I continue to educate, whether I want to or not. And as I've gotten older, I don't want to get out of my van and go in and get my Starbucks anymore. And there are no drive-thrus, right? So you know what I do? I call Starbucks, the one right in front of my window, and I call them and say, "Hello, I'm in a wheelchair. I'm sitting in your handicapped parking stall. Can you bring me out this drink?" And I realize, after I have my drink and I'm happier, that I've just educated somebody quite a bit. Number one, they brought me the drink happily, because it's Starbucks, right? And I usually tell them what kind of a bill I have. If I have a $10 bill, just bring me change or something. And I've taught them a little bit about interacting with me. But believe me, that is a secondary thought. If it happens, it happens. And throughout my daily life now, it happens a lot. But I'm not out looking to do it. I'm trying to live life out to the fullest for myself and my family. And along the way comes all the education. So it's going to happen. And I think it's something that goes with the territory. You can't allow yourself to get burdened down by it, because it's everywhere. And then, you know, the Hell's Angels guys in line at the grocery store look back at me and say, "Hey, bro, can we buy your food for you?" And I'm thinking, okay, do I look poor, number one? You know, why are they doing this? And I go, sure. Why not, you know?
Yes.
So there's even more education that just falls in place.
I'm definitely stealing that Starbucks tip.
I am too.
I will be doing so that next time. I like that a lot. But for me, I feel like it's almost a double burden. So not only do I have to live this life and you know, the challenges that come with being in a wheelchair, but I also have to educate others and make other people comfortable about me being in a wheelchair. And so sometimes it does get frustrating and draining, and you don't want to do it, but if I'm the vehicle for change, or I can help bring awareness to disability, then I'm more than willing and happy to do it. But it does become draining and burdensome at times.
Well, you know, I really enjoy educating the community. And, you know, we were having a discussion, and I was just talking about all these positive things and just sort of my outlook on life. And, you know, I just sort of view it as like a challenge. And you know, there's so many people that don't know and don't have the knowledge that it's, you know, it's never going to, I don't think we're ever going to, educate everybody. But it's nice to to be able to talk to, talk to people about adaptive sports and universal design and talk about that over and over again, because it's so much a part of me and you know, what great ideas that I can spark to a person that doesn't have a disability about adaptive sports. And what I think is so powerful about just constantly educating is, you know, someone may not have a disability, but they may know someone with a disability. So if I talk to them about adaptive sports, they can tell, you know, their friend who may not even be active and might just stay, you know, in their house and watch TV and play video games about, you know, wheelchair basketball, about sitting volleyball. And then that transfer of knowledge just keeps growing and growing and growing. And so that's what keeps me motivated to continue to talk with people and to educate and talk about what I'm really passionate about. And you know, at times it does get draining, but I just look at it as more opportunities to have conversations and see, you know, what, you know, another person might be interested in. And maybe we can, you know, create something very unique. And so that's just sort of my perspective on things.
Appreciate that. This question is specifically for those with that are the parents, the family members. So for the parents who have children with disabilities, how do you balance the attention given to your children with disabilities and your children without disabilities?
You pray a lot. it's been a significant issue in my family, because for my daughter's disability manifests itself in a way to where intellectually she's 100% there. She has a genius level IQ. But for her disability has meant years and years and years of visits to the doctor's office. It has meant blood work, and because of the work that we did, it's meant a whole lot of advocacy, a whole lot of flying to Sacramento to go testify, to do things, a lot of being videotaped, and so that brought on its own stress. But then when my son was diagnosed with autism, that really started to eclipse our entire world. He really is the center of focus in our family, and I had to have a really important talk with my daughters one day and just say, look, I get it that it's really hard to be his sibling. I get it that it's really hard that I spend so much of my time going from therapy to therapy to therapy. Because my children were a little bit older, I could also say, I really need you to understand that I am doing the best that I can for you, and I love you immensely. And I will do everything that I can to create space for us where we do things that are not related to Tony and Tony's autism. But I am one person with three children. And so my girls are really cool. Having said that, they're, you know, like I said, I brag about my kids a lot. But they understood, and they were great about it. As they've gotten older, they've kind of continued to respect the fact that I am dealing with this too. You know, I am not living with their disabilities in the way that they are. I am living with their disabilities in a different way. So we do things. My daughter just came home for my birthday, which was fabulous, and we made sure to include time with my son. We made sure to do things where my son was not there and not even really much a part of the conversation, but we're very, very intentional about that.
I agree with what you're saying. I think it's very much intentional that you have to look at how siblings also react to how they're, for us, it's our daughter Grace, our 10-year-old daughter Grace, and she's going, Sarah's saying Grace, and how she views, because she's looking at us as parents and she's gonna gain this vision into a world and how we're treating our daughter with a disability and how we're treating our daughter without a disability. What we tend to have to make sure for Grace is to make sure she's being a sister and not a second mom. As a 10-year-old, little 10-year-old, right? Sarah's going, no. Because she has this heart to want to help, which we want her to continue to foster that, but we don't want her to feel the burden, in a sense, that she has to also be doing that. That's mom and dad's job to be. But as a 10-year-old, I know she's like, maybe she forgot, or she can do, or I can help her, or I'll do some things for her. And I think, you know, as sisters, that's great. But we really try to help her see, okay, let mom and dad do this. This is, we don't want you to feel that, because we want her to be her sister and not feel that she has to be doing specific things if Sarah needs it. I think the other part that's really important is that individual time with Grace and with Sarah. You know, we'll do, like tonight we're gonna do a date night together with Sarah and Grace, and then there's times when we do separate, and there's time when Olivia's with each one of them separately, and so that they're having individual equal time in that sense, and then we're everywhere together. I think that's important too, is that where Sarah goes, and if it's appropriate, Grace is there, and if Grace is going, it's appropriate for Sarah, Sarah's there, because of that, we're wanting people to see that it is not a separate life that's being led. So I think that's important.
I'm learning, right? I have a 5-year-old and a 3-year-old. But it has, you know, from the day that Kate was born, that was heavy on our heart. What are we gonna do when our daughter is in a NICU that is, you know, over an hour, you know, in traffic 2 hours away from where our 2-year-old's life was? And so we had to start, or almost 2-year-old, not even yet, but asking those questions and being very intentional about time. But I think on the flip side, I just want to also say this, as a parent, the other piece that we're also asking is, we spend all of this time making sure that Kate's getting the right therapy and having opportunities to grow and bloom and become who we know she can be and who she wants to become. And we're trying to do the same for Joshua, but we're making sure we have special time. He calls it special time. Did I have special time with mom today? You know, with him. But wanting to create space to have special time that's not therapy related for my daughter Kate too, so that her recollection of our growing up days wasn't that mom and dad spent time with me when we went to OT and mom and dad spent time with Joshua on a special date to the park or a special date to the library or a special date to Starbucks. So there's you know, I guess one more step too to how we ask those questions.
Thank you. We have some great questions coming in, and some of them are overlapping, so I'm going to smoosh them together. So if it sounds like it's kind of your question, that's what I'm doing. So a lot of questions coming in, quite a few about invisible disabilities or inward disabilities. So how do I help students or others who have those kinds of disabilities? What services are available for those students? So speak maybe a little bit on more of the invisible side of disability.
Beth, actually, do you want to handle this question?
Sure. Okay. So I'm the director of the Learning Enrichment Center. You probably can all hear me.
For the recording.
I'm the director of the Learning Enrichment Center, and I oversee 4 programs. One of them is disability services. And so most of our students that come in have non-apparent learning disabilities or psychological disabilities. We have some that have qualified for disability based on other conditions, but most of them are non-apparent. So we provide accommodations for those students who qualify so that they can have an equal playing field to students who do not have that disability. So accommodations are never meant to leverage a student. They're meant to give them an equal playing field, because most students don't have some of the learning maybe process issues that other students do. And so we do have some students with autism, Asperger's, as they call it, or on the spectrum. And so we have just a really broad range of students that are coming to our campus. I will tell you, it's growing. But what we try to do is really help those students to feel like they belong and to feel like they're supported. We also have tutoring and supplemental instruction, and we have CLEP and DSST, you know, so that they have access to all kinds of academic support resources for them. A lot of times we work with faculty or student life members to, you know, help those students as well. So I hope that answered the question.
Yeah. Panelists, do we want to add anything?
I just have to say, and I know that I'm kind of biased here, I think that Beth and Dr. Stewart, who handle the undergraduate accommodations, do a fabulous job of really getting to know each student for who they are as a human being, and then planning a series of accommodations that will indeed help to give them equal access. And it's been a real blessing to be able to work with both of them. I mean, to be able to help anybody is a blessing, in my opinion, but to see the amount of devotion that they give their jobs and how much they truly love the students and how far they are willing to go to make sure that students' needs are being taken care of and that faculty members' needs are being taken care of and that, you know, social needs are being taken care of. They spend a whole lot of time thinking about what is going to best serve the students of the university. So I had to show you guys some love because you really do
shout
do an
out,
incredible
yes.
job.
We so appreciate the amazing work you do in the LEC. Thank you. Thank you. A couple of questions around accessibility. So talking specifically about APU in this campus. So how have you experienced accessibility on this campus? Are there things that we could do as a campus, students, staff, and faculty to make this a more accessible or more inclusive place?
I guess I'll go. you know, I think that every, you know, university or place can do, can always look to do better when it comes to accessibility. And I would say for the most part, these institutions are doing the best that they can. They can't, you know, not every place is going to be perfectly, you know, accessible, but it will be, it or it should be at least, accessible enough to navigate through, you know, this campus, for example. And I had, you know, a really great experience here when I was a student and even coming back now and seeing all the renovations in parts of the campus and the big buttons that are placed, you know, around is just really great for me to see, even in the CAF where I had some breakfast and I was looking at the plates that where they were positioned. They were positioned at my eye level, so I know I don't have to get up and reach for it. It was just like right there, and so there. I think there have been a lot of little things that have been improved here at the university, and I think those are the little things are what really matters when it comes to making a person's a student's experience who has a disability, you know, really worth you know, their time. So yeah.
Okay. Gonna move a little bit to communities of faith. So share experiences you've had, either positive or negative, within your community of faith. And maybe, you know, one of the topics we talked about is just how faith is impacted by experience of disability. So both in the internal personal sense, but maybe also in the communal sense, talk about communities of faith and how faith interacts with disability.
Well, when you begin life with a disability, I think your approach is a little different than when a disability occurs in your teen years or later, in my observation. I think when you start life with a disability or close to starting life, you learn an early reliance on God for everything. I mean, there's not a day that I don't get up and it's like, I know this is a day that could be adventuresome. And I'm not kidding. We're talking adventures and just crazy things that happen and unexpected. And often it's the equipment or the vehicles or the ramps that don't work. And you never know when this stuff's going to happen. It could be something somebody says to you and it's like, really? You know, and you just start life every day, I believe, with a little more dependence on God than I would have had without a disability. I can't speak for others. They may always be starting their day this way. But for me, I have to start my day this way. And it's a quiet prayer, Lord, help me through this day. helped me understand it, put it in perspective. It's the daily challenges. And they don't go away. The next day is the same way, and the day after is the same way. And then along the way comes perhaps some takeaways and some things you used to be able to do that you can't do anymore. And you're dealing with the frustration of that, and you're dealing with the spiritual battle of that. So every day is a day of trust. If I had to do it over again, I would do it the same way. If God gave me a choice when I was 8 months old to live that life or live a more robust life physically, I would still choose this life because I know how it brings me closer to God. And it happens in my entire thought processes when I meet people. I tease my friends who are sitting around talking about how difficult the snow was and the skiing and their ankle got twisted a little bit. And I'm sitting there for 30 minutes and finally I say, I have no sympathy for you guys, okay? None, zero. You know, I mean, just let's not even go there. So it changes your perspective on life, and I wouldn't trade that for anything. I really wouldn't.
So when I was born with muscular dystrophy, I wasn't diagnosed until I was 3. And I always had the understanding that it's a progressive disorder and it would get worse in time. And it wasn't until about, I was 13 or 14, and I would fall a lot. And when I was about 13 or 14, I woke up one morning and I went to get out of bed. I fell and I wasn't able to get back up. And that was from that point on, I used a wheelchair. And people always ask me, like, was it scary? How did you cope with that truth and all of a sudden not being able to walk anymore? And my answer has always been God. My faith in Him and knowing that, you know, He designed me this way for a reason, and having the understanding that it would eventually happen, I kind of mentally prepared myself so it wasn't as scary when the moment actually occurred. And muscular dystrophy is a terminal illness, and most people don't make it past the age of 17. And so I don't like to say my age, but I'm past 17. And so being that I've moved past life expectancy and have always been told that even though I have muscular dystrophy, my symptoms aren't as severe as most, I've always felt extremely blessed and really used my faith in that way to just remind myself of my blessing. When my sister got sick, I watched her really struggle in accepting that, and it really challenged her faith. Her illness made her grow more distant from God, and so that was a really challenging time for my family, just in supporting her as she questioned, like, why me? And I'm doing everything right, I'm a good Christian, yet still I'm in that this position in life now. And so that was really tough for me, as my own experience of, like, handling it well and adjusting to it well, but then seeing that she's struggled with that. And so I believe onset and how you adjust really has a lot to do with, you know, your ability to hold on to your faith and spirituality in those moments.
So when I was born, I had a hole in my heart, and so I had 2 open heart surgeries when I was a baby. And the doctors didn't think that I was going to be able to live. So I was in the hospital for about 6 months after I was born, and then later on was diagnosed with cerebral palsy. So when I finally had the realization that this all happened in my life and was able to conceptualize it and come with this realization, it would, you know, really made me feel, you know, grateful and blessed that I had the opportunity to just, you know, live the life that I live, and that every day I want to make, you know, I want to make every day the best day that I can, and know that you know, God has me here for a reason, and because of my disability, I've been given unique talents, and so I want to bless other people with the talents that I have, and help you know, anybody that has a disability feel you know, better about their situation, because you know, it can be tough, and not a lot of people have the same, you know, mindset or needs, or they just need a little bit more support, and so that's how I look at it.
As a parent, I, you know, my wife and I, Olivia, we often talk about how maybe how the church hasn't done this part of life well, and how maybe disability is talked about, or and just people in general, we don't do uncomfortable well, right? They don't. How do you approach that? What do you say? And then when you do say, and maybe not the questions, but when you say, well, God knows what you can handle, and you know, hearing things, or using some of those Christian talk or vocabulary to and again, you can't fault them because they're trying to connect, but there is that conversation that I know we're praying to get to, where it is more of the relationship that you have with people to understand what it's like to have a disability or be a parent to a child with a disability. But I do know that God exists specifically because of my daughter, Sarah. So many people, when we're in church, will say, wow, I have never seen anyone worship like her. She prays for people. She prays for us, you know, when we're not feeling well. So never that I question God's existence, but man, do I ever know that he exists because of how he's made my daughter. And it is only God, I think, that in his awesomeness that can reach people at every level, intellectual, physical, wherever you are. If you're on the highest end of the scale of genius and are on the lowest scale, I mean, God is going to reach you. And so I know when Sarah, we used to laugh because Sarah wakes up at the crack of dawn, like, as soon as the sunrise, you know, is cracking. And I remember one morning she was singing praise and worship music, and I'm looking at my wife going, can't she be quiet? And then I'm thinking, man, I'm quenching her spirit, you know? I'm like, I can't do this, you know? It's like, we've had these conversations. Just let her sing. And but I think for as parents, I think the having those conversations and hearing how people discuss disability, I think that's why we continue to be in the work that we do as advocates, to help kind of shape that as well, and how we treat our daughter and how we live life with our daughters, the best example of our education about our daughter and someone, you know, with a disability, an intellectual disability. So, yeah.
I think for me as a parent, one of the greatest pleasures has been to see the way that God works through my children, and specifically through my son. My son has remained relatively unchurched, because when you are autistic and you have a lot of sensory issues, vibrations from organs and loud music and bright colored light coming in from a stained glass window, combined with a whole lot of people wearing perfume, is kind of a lot to deal with. And so, yeah, major sensory overload. And so we've always kind of respected that for him. And also the fact that, I mean, my son will be 20 next month. 20 years ago, when you were trying to incorporate a child into a church program, it looked a lot different. I'm not sure how it looks now. I hope it looks better.
But God works through my child. God speaks through my child. My son does not see himself as an autistic person. My son sees himself as a film editor. My son sees himself as a Jedi Knight. You'd not believe the lightsabers in my house. My son sees himself as somebody who cares deeply about his mom and his sister and his dogs. And he speaks to people that way. He speaks to people as himself, and he is incredibly open. So I remember one time we were in the Social Security office, which is kind of a rough place to be, and I had to bring my son in, which was incredibly concerning to me because my son, being autistic, can also get violent. He can get very excited. He can really cause a scene. And so we were sitting with the woman from Social Security, and she's typing in his information, and he kind of leans towards her, and I'm going, oh, here we go. He's gonna say he's George Lucas again, and which he does. And he said, you know, God loves you very much. God put you here today. You're doing a good job. And I cry, and the woman cries, but that's what he does. He does not care. He is so bold about the things that he says, and when he feels like people need to hear that, when they need to hear the Spirit, you know, I mean, he has addressed educators and IEP meetings by saying, you know, the truth will set you free, John 8:32b, you know. So he, I just love that kid. So I think for me, it's been such an incredible blessing because I get to see that all happen. I get to see God move so forcefully within my child, and I get to see God affect so many people around him just because he can be that conduit. He's not, the kid has no filter, I promise. So, you know, but, and that is a blessing because he can really speak to people in ways that, you know, that I can't, that I would be too scared, I would be too concerned about what the person would think or that I would offend the person. He'll just come right out there and say it.
So in our conversation, I think we got the message that the church can be a great source of encouragement and also a great source of frustration. We have some people in the audience today who are asking about encouragement, specifically have a family member or a friend who is experiencing a disability. One has a family member who was began to use a wheelchair and not be able to speak 8 years ago, and they're asking for your advice. How can I be an encouragement? How can I give these people that are in my life hope? Would you have any advice for folks that would find themselves in that situation?
I think it's important to find something in every child, and not just a disabled child, that they can build on. Some type of talent, some type of unique skill and ability. And that's going to take some work sometimes. You have to experiment a little bit. For me, I was a child singer. And don't ask me why, I just sang. And my parents realized that maybe I should just be singing. And so they hooked me up with Shriners, and I sang all over the place as a Shriners child and in a wheelchair, and sang and sang and sang. The beauty of that is that was my thing. That's what I did. And I couldn't do much of anything else. You know, no great intellectual accomplishments as a child, and you know, I had trouble just physically ambulating schools and so on and so forth, but I could sing. And it kind of laid a foundation for me that I had something in life, something that I could build on. And I think for every child, they need that, whatever it is. And I know parents who are experimenting with that, trying to find that thing their child is interested in that perhaps they're a little better at. And that's not even so important as the fact that the child is interested in it. And if it's in the art world, music, art, applied art, There seems to be some healing with that. The creative process seems to provide extra healing. And I know a lot of disabled children who pursue art in many forms, music and visual and photography and other things, and they start laying the foundation of a skill base for themselves.
I think it's important to know that when someone acquires a disability, they go through stages similar to grief and loss stages. And it's not a linear progression. It can be secular. And so there may be days where they're angry or they have acceptance. And just supporting them in that process while they gain acceptance and go through those various stages. But it is a loss when you have an ability and you lose that ability, or there becomes limits to that ability. You know, it is a loss. And so helping them to understand it and supporting them while they deal with it, I think that's important.
And then I would also add to that, you know, trying to connect, that person with someone else who may have acquired a disability as well, because you can only do so much with not having a disability that you fully don't understand. So just connecting them with somebody else who has been through a similar experience can really provide some insight and some comfort, I think.
I would have to say, be willing to be open to learning about your person's condition, your friend's condition, or your loved one's condition. And also take the time to become aware of the social and the legal and the governmental issues that are surrounding that. You know, as the parent of a disabled child, I am expected to be a legal expert and an educational expert and a financial whiz. And that's okay, you know, I like learning a lot of different things, but what makes me so happy is when people come up to me and they say, you know, we know that there's a struggle right now getting enough funding for special education. You know, special education in this country is chronically underfunded, and we are trying to do something about it. Knowing that people will stand with me and stand with the community to advocate for things like better care in group homes, better access to medical care, better access to dental care, better legal representation when it comes to working with regional centers. That's huge. That is a fight that we can't do on our own. You know, generally speaking, I am very engrossed in all of my children's issues, and so then to have time left over at the end of the day to continue to fight for them on a state level or on a national level with politicians is hard. But if I know that I have friends who are helping me, who are willing to advocate, who are willing to talk to their friends, who are willing to join the fight, that really does take some of the pressure off of me, because then I'm not doing it alone anymore, and neither are they.
Great. This time has gone way too fast. We have addressed many of the questions. There are a few that we didn't get to, and I apologize for that. There are a few that were specific questions for a specific panel member, and maybe I'll suggest that that's a connection you make. If there's a specific question you want to ask one of our panel members, maybe you can catch them before they leave today and introduce yourself and maybe set up a time for coffee, take them out and ask your question. So would you join me in appreciating our panel? First. I know I so appreciate your vulnerability and your openness, your willingness to answer questions and to help us to learn, so thank you so much. I do also want to acknowledge before we go that this week had a lot of work behind it and a lot of people that were planning events and so forth. So if you were a part of that committee, just wave your hand so we can acknowledge you as well. Thank you so much. And I believe, Dr. Franson, you had something that you wanted to do before we closed up?
Just a little bit of quick history of how this all was conceived. It was because of Travis. Travis is an alum here from 2011 and was a tremendous advocate for disability awareness when he was here as a student. He would call me on a regular basis when he was at New Mexico and say, hey, when are you gonna get me out there speaking chapel? When can I tell our story? How are we doing with this? How are we doing with that? I said, all right, Travis, all right. And so we put it together for him to speak at the Student Leadership Chapel on Wednesday, which was phenomenal as he told his story. That led to a conversation that I had with Beth. And then Beth began to envision a whole week of awareness. And those of us that have kind of helped marginally, I'm certainly one of those, it's just my relationship with Travis. That woman has done an absolutely amazing job. I can't imagine, I could never have imagined that we could have got to this place, Beth. And this is not just a week anymore. This is a movement on campus that is so powerful. And listening to you folks share and the openness from your heart, this is Christian community at its best. And we know that the church doesn't do this well just because they don't understand. Well, for those of us who are able body, able mind, to be able to understand more, we then can be ambassadors. And I want to, before I have you come up, Beth, I want to recognize one individual here. This is David Mandani. And David is a student here, and 97, schizophrenic, had 5 or 6 episodes here. I was at the Mental Health in the Church conference at Saddleback with about 3,000 or 4,000 people, and I saw him speaking up on the stage, and I thought, I know that guy. And then not too long ago, about a month ago, we interacted at the CCCU conference, and he just told me at that conference that he's not saying this, but I think he is the first pastor of mental health in America. Saddleback has hired him full-time, and the Warrens, you know, have taken a tremendous tragedy and turned it around into this magnificent awareness campaign as it relates to mental illness. And this is our alum who is now going to be leading, along with the Warrens, that movement at Saddleback. So when Susanna talked about a double burden, you know, the burden of the challenge, but the other part of the burden is a lack of awareness and understanding. When we begin to learn and we be able to become allies and advocates, oh my gosh, you talk about it. Revival in a community and the kinds of things that can happen. But with no further ado, Beth, would you please come up here?